So thanks to the last video, now we know how to create weapons. I won't be covering that process here because I don't want the video to take 5 hours for just 5 weapons, right? Now the question is, now that we know how to make stuff, what do we make? Well, I asked you that a long time ago and I got some very good answers. In this video, I'll be taking a look at some of your ideas and we're gonna implement them one by one. So I decided to do this per category. This video's category is ordinary hitscan weapons, like firearms and stuff like that. Actually, it's exclusively firearms this time around. And next time we're gonna cover projectile-based weapons, so everybody who's mentioned grenade launchers, homing missiles and stuff like that, don't worry, you'll get some spotlight too. All the code here is on GitHub, as always. Feel free to use it in your mods, although this is educational material, so it's not really much special, you know, but hey, it's a good starting point. Starting off with the simplest one, Uncommon Saucers suggests a burst fire shotgun. We can modify the vanilla Half-Life shotgun for this one. In essence, you would move the shooting from secondary attack over to weapon idle, and you'll see exactly how we're gonna do that. Basically, add a variable that's gonna count how many shots were fired for this burst period, yeah? Let's write an enum so that this variable's values can actually have some meaning. By default, the variable's gonna be burst idle. When the player shoots, we'll flip it to burst trigger, and then start counting in weapon idle until it reaches 2 or 3 or whatever, where you wanna go, basically. Don't forget to visit weapons.cpp and actually add this variable to the shotgun's save restore table. Now let's do the stuff in secondary attack. We're gonna set this variable to burst trigger. In weapon idle, we check the burst state, and if it's burst trigger or above, we increment it. When the variable becomes greater than a certain number, that is the number of burst shots we want to make, we're going to reset it back to burst idle, thus completing the circle. And now we just call primary attack. And that's done. That's how you do burst fire. Well, one of the ways you can do it, and this is probably one of the, I guess, easiest, I don't know, depends on you. Now, onto Valpuccio's sniper rifle idea. So we already did the burst fire stuff, like right now, and we previously, in a previous video, made the Glock semi-automatic, so we're not exactly gonna do that here. What's interesting about this one though is scopes and recoil. So let's do recoil first, like that's pretty easy. We're gonna base this weapon on the 357 because it shoots bullets and it can zoom in and out in certain cases. You thought I was gonna go for the crossbow, huh? Zooming in and out basically just involves setting the player's FOV, it's as simple as that really. If it's 0, that is unset, just set it to something like 30, 40, whatever, depending on your zoom level or whatnot. And if it isn't 0, just set it back to 0. That's so simple. Now, recoil. Visual recoil is done inside events. If you remember them from the last video, you'll know that they basically play sounds, or they're used to typically play sounds and do effects on the client, so that the server doesn't have to care about it, essentially. If you find EVFirePython in EVHLDM, you're gonna see that it calls vPunchAxis, and that's exactly what punches your screen upwards. So yeah, that's pretty much it, just use that. Now, it's worth noting that this is just a visual effect, it's not actually going to make your aim vector any different. In order to do something like that, you can basically add a variable to your weapon which acts like a cooldown of some sorts. The more you shoot, the higher it goes, and the more idle your weapon is, the lower it goes. And it would just directly add to the randomness of the aim vector, it's as simple as that. Now, the scope. Oh boy, that one's really interesting, because there are so many ways you can approach it. The way Opposing Force does it is by simply defining a really basic sprite when you're zoomed in, you know, in the weapon something .txt file. Maybe that's a bit disappointing, and I will admit it is. You were probably expecting some code that would, you know, draw black borders and a hole in the middle, yeah? That's what I believe is done by Counter-Strike, Poke646, and HL Invasion. Now here's the thing, as cool as that is, it involves the HUD on the client side as well as the Triangle API, and that's something we'll only get to do in chapters 6 and 7. We'll get there though, don't worry. Taga Buchholz wants to see a machine gun that actually displays how much ammo there is on the belt. Yeah, this one is pretty simple. We can take a look at the Opposing Force updated code and see what's exactly going on over there. Well, would you look at that, it sets the body group of the view model. Wow. I covered body groups a long time ago, you should definitely watch that, but this thing is kind of tricky, let me tell you, because depending on the SDK you use, maybe all of them, this would not exactly work. If in the last video you followed the part about the Better Weapons SDK, you would know that the body group gets overridden in the weapon prediction code for the 357's scope in Deathmatch. So what they did instead was send it to the weapon event, weapon firing event, as a parameter, and upon playing the animation, you know, set the body group as well. This is a little hacky, it's something I don't like about a weapon system in the SDK, but oh well, it's easier to just tack something on and run with it instead of properly implementing or modifying a system to do the thing you want to do. This is a tutorial about the fundamentals of adding weapon features, not about system design, so for now we're just gonna roll with it. Lastly, Wegeo Revenant asks for dual-wielded pistols, which can also act individually. That is, if you pick one up, you have one, if you pick another one up, you have two. Yay. This one can be approached in so many different ways, and that's why something like this can be super daunting for beginners. But don't worry, there's a relatively simple way to do this. You would basically create two weapon classes, one is the single pistol, the other is both pistols together. See where this is going? We're gonna take a couple view models from the masterpiece that is the specialists. Now, I don't wanna teach anybody how to steal assets, because there's enough of that already. I just want you to know we're doing this purely for educational purposes, so we like have a decent visual representation of a dual-wielded weapon, and an accompanying singular one. Alright, so respect the original authors of the mod, even if they may be no longer active in the community. And, I mean, if you can make these models yourself, then absolutely go for it, you don't have to steal. So, code-wise, we can just clone the Glock for the single pistol and inherit from that for the dual-wielded pistol class. This way we can avoid a tiny bit of code duplication. The only thing that will differ in the dual-wielded class is the fact that it has a different view model and it has 2 times more ammo everywhere. And it plays different animations like cycling left and right, or heck, you can like make primary attack shoot the left one and secondary attack shoot the right pistol. In that case, make sure you have separate magazine variables for both of them. Now, all that is really left is to make sure that if you pick up a pistol while already having one in your inventory, you would get the dual-wielded pistol. There's 3 classes that we can have, cases, not classes. Number 1, player has neither of them, so pick up the single pistol. Number 2, the player has the single pistol, so pick up the akimbo. And number 3, the player has both, so just extract ammo, get the magazine out, you know? Now, cases 1 and 2 are very trivial to cover. Simply override add duplicate, because that's what the weapon system calls upon the player picking up a weapon that they already have. Case 3 is also simple. Check if the player has the weapon, and if so, extract ammo. Otherwise, create the dual-wielded pistol entity, give it to the player, and despawn the single pistol off the ground. And that's basically it.
I see you are in this mess too.
Oh man, this is so good. Like, we're really getting into the fun stuff in the series now. Now, you may have noticed by now that there is an awful lot of code repetition here. Yeah, that's pretty bad. We're just kind of, you know, copy-pasting code that all could have been maybe wrapped around in some simple functions and stuff. I leave that to you as homework. One day I will absolutely talk about writing fairly clean weapon code, you know, ironing out the quirks in the weapon system and so on. However, it won't exactly be in this very series. I feel it's more adequate for Half-Life SDK extras, because remember, this series, like all we've done so far, is really just the bare bones basics, the fundamentals of the SDK. None of this stuff is advanced. And this is, I would say, a little more intermediate territory, so yeah. Anyway, in the next video, we're gonna take a look at some projectile-based weapons, and we're gonna have lots of fun with those. So yeah, until then, happy programming!